Hi everyone, I'm Felipe, and today I'm going to talk to you about a 20% project that I worked on last year, namely to port a C++ library to Rust. First, let me give you an overview of the project. The main objectives were to evaluate the feasibility of porting C++ code to Rust, in particular annotating it with lifetimes and enforcing the exclusivity rule, to see how idiomatic the ported code would be, especially how much in safe code it would be needed. And we also wanted to investigate the ergonomics and the learning curve, the engineering productivity, and measure the runtime performance overhead of using Rust. The library I've ported is called WOFF2. It's a C++ library used to convert font files from TTF and similar formats into the WOFF2 file format, and vice versa. Even though it was written in C++, its usage of classes is very similar to C structs, with very few methods and no special constructors or destructors. It also uses int for most integer values, except when directly writing to or reading from a file. And the reason why I'm pointing this out here is that this caused quite a bit of extra work during the port, as I'll go into details later on. The library depends on Abseo and Brutley, which is a C library used to compress and decompress data. And one of the reasons why this library was chosen is that it contains about 6,700 lines of code, which should be possible for a single person to port. And this included a few unit tests, a few fuzzers, and multiple end-to-end tests over a big corpus of font files. The existing unit tests only covered the main data structures, which are shared between WOFF2 and WOFF1, and unfortunately, there were no unit tests for the WOFF2-specific logic. The end result of the port to Rust contains about 6,200 lines of code, including unit tests, end-to-end tests, and fuzzers. It depends on the Brutley library for compression and decompression, and also depends on the log crate, which I use as a convenient replacement for printing to STDR. And here I could have done logging using just the standard library printing functions, but the log crate was a bit more convenient and made the intent clear. Lastly, as I mentioned, the C++ code uses Abseo flags, but since there is no direct equivalent for Abseo in Rust, I use the arg crate, developed by the Fuchsia team. For a bit of context, let's also talk about my experience with Rust and C++ before starting this project. I was an advanced beginner in Rust, having written a bit less than 10,000 lines of code, which included a few small pet projects, a university project, and some open source contributions. It might be important to note that I had no experience with larger Rust codebases, where complex data structure lifetimes are involved, nor was I experienced with newer Rust constructs like pin. Had a bit more experience with C++, but it was not very deep either. I had used it in a few university classes, some small personal projects, and programming competitions, and a bit during an internship at Google. In total, I have probably written less than 100,000 lines of code in C++, but I did have much more experience reading large C++ code bases, both at Google and in open source projects. Based on this experience, I was confident that I could port most C++ code to Rust, possibly after some fighting with the borrow checker. Of course, I did not expect my code to be the cleanest version possible, although I always tried writing the best possible code. Now let me show you how I approached the migration itself. I ported the WOFF2 library from C++ to Rust in two passes. The first pass was as literal and mechanical a translation as reasonably possible, with very few exceptions that I'll mention in the next line. That took me 12 days of work. And in the second pass, I refactored the code to be more idiomatic Rust, which took me about 8 days of work for a grand total of 20 days. In the first pass, I migrated one file at a time together with any existing unit tests, but often there were none. I then migrated end-to-end tests and fuzz tests at the end of the first pass. Since there was no C++ Rust interop, I only ran end-to-end tests after I finished the first pass. And as I've just mentioned, in the first pass, I intended to do a literal translation, but I deviated from a purely mechanical translation in a few ways. In the Rust code, I've used options where it made sense. I used lices instead of pointer length pairs, which did introduce a few bugs that I'll mention later. I used references instead of raw pointers. I used precisely sized integer types everywhere. I've also translated C++ integer coercion that truncate values into Rust check conversions that trap on truncation, unless I recognize the code relied on truncation. I translated C++ unsigned integer arithmetic that wraps an overflow into regular arithmetic operators that trap an overflow in debug mode, unless I recognize the code relied on overflow. I also used FFI to call broadly. And as already mentioned, I used the argcrate as an imperfect replacement for abseil flags. Although I was careful, these refactorings still introduce a few bugs only found by end-to-end tests. I will show you some of these bugs later in the presentation. Among the changes done during the second pass, I fixed bugs found by end-to-end tests at the end of the first pass. I removed all unsafe blocks, with the exception of the FFI call true broadly, which is inherently unsafe. I improved readability and made code more idiomatic, for instance by refactoring all functions that use output params to use results instead. And I applied most Clippy suggestions. Let's look at an example here. As I've mentioned before, the WOFF2 C++ code relies heavily on type coercions, since it uses int almost everywhere, except when reading from or writing to a font file. In the example here, we have a function called writeTriplet, which takes two ints, x and y, gets their absolute values, and then sorts each of them in a vector of bytes called glyphstream. But in the highlighted code here, you can see that it implicitly assumes that both x and y fit in two bytes. Unfortunately, that is not obvious at all when you read the code that calculates x and y and calls the writeTriplet function. Therefore, refactoring this while porting the code to Rust took a lot of effort, since I had to consider what integer size was needed in each place and bubble up or down the call stack where needed. After doing all this, I was much more confident that the code worked as intended and was not hiding hard-to-debug integer truncation bugs. So I believe the refactoring would have been useful even in the C++ version of the code. Let's now talk about the test coverage and the bugs I ran into. First, let's talk about tests. I only converted existing tests and did not write any new tests, with one exception. A simple unit test from the broadly FFI, since the FFI glue code was new code that I added. The lack of unit tests made the migration much harder because the biggest and most complicated files, WOFF2ENC and WOFF2DEC for encode and decode, had no unit tests and took significantly longer to port. Just the WOFF2DEC took me 4 full days of work. Also, these files had the most bugs introduced, which were only found and fixed after the first pass once the end-to-end tests were ported. Just to give an idea, the impact of the lack of unit tests, out of the 20 bugs I fixed in Rust code, 11 were bugs in those two files, WOFF2ENC and WOFF2DEC, which had no unit tests, and 3 bugs were in other files that had unit tests, but in functions that were not covered by these tests. Which means 70% of the bugs introduced during the port were in code not covered by unit tests. And from the 20 bugs introduced during the port that were found by end-to-end tests and fuzzers, 14 of those bugs were caused by wrong mechanical conversions. For instance, I used wrong buffer sizes, I flipped Boolean conditions, or forgot else clauses. 3 bugs were caused by using different integer sizes, so truncation and overflow. 2 bugs were borrow mute errors, which means the code violated runtime borrowing rules for refcell. 1 bug was a panic found by a fuzzer, because the code was missing a check on the buffer size when reading from a file. And I also fixed 1 bug in unsafe code that I wrote during the first phase. When porting this code in the first pass, I thought a lot about why it was safe from a lifetime perspective, that is, no use of a free bug. But I forgot to think about whether it satisfied the rule of exclusivity, and it turns out it didn't. I found this bug when I was trying to convert the unsafe block to safe code, and the borrow checker was pointing out a mutable aliasing issue, which means the rule of exclusivity was broken. Even though it broke the borrow checker rules, it read from one field of an object and wrote to another field of the same object, so it might have been okay. And lastly, note that most of these bugs could have been caught with better unit test coverage. I believe this part of the presentation has many learnings. The first is that good unit tests help detect almost all classes of bugs, so test coverage is important. It might make sense to write more unit tests before starting the migration. The second learning is that the risk of human error when doing a mechanical translation is non-zero. Note here that I had 3 to 4 careful reviewers in every commit. Importantly, I believe these errors could be avoided if the syntactic transformation from C++ to Rust was done by a tool. This risk increases when doing non-trivial semantic changes during the migration, no matter how simple. One example is using slices instead of raw pointers in lint, which leads to the next learning. Port code using unsafe raw pointers in lint then refactor to use slices. Or as an alternative, refactor the C++ code to use std span before migrating it to Rust. The fourth learning is that simple static analysis can detect some obvious borrow-mute errors. Nonetheless, catching all borrow-mute error before runtime is not always feasible, so it's important to have good test coverage when using RefSim. Lastly, it should come as no surprise, but having good knowledge of the problem domain helps to understand what's the correct and expected behavior. For example, whether the code relies on integer truncation or wrapping arithmetic overflow. Let's talk about the performance comparison between the C++ and Rust versions of the WOFF2 code. First of all, I should mention that the WOFF2 C++ code already included some benchmarks, which I ported to Rust. They measure both compression and decompression speed, and I ran them over a folder containing dozens, if not hundreds, of TTF files. I ran both the compression and decompression benchmarks using Google internal benchmarking tool, whose results we see here in this slide. The graph shows the average execution time and the 95 percentile confidence intervals, where C++ is the base. Rust was an average 0.3% faster in the decompressed benchmark, while it was 0.3% slower in the compressed one. But importantly, these differences were not statistically significant. But before you attach much meaning to them, I must say that once we looked at the flame graphs, we realized the difference in compression speed must be measurement noise, because both implementations spent almost the entire execution time in Rutley rather than the code being ported. That was over 99.5% for compression and over 60% for decompression. I also measured peak memory usage of both implementations, and the results indicated no significant difference in memory consumption between them. So the conclusions we got from the benchmarks are that performance is comparable when using compilation mode opt in Bazel, both in terms of speed and memory usage. It was not shown in these slides, but Rust is much faster in fast build and debug modes than C++ for the decompressed benchmark, 85% faster in fast build and 32% in debug mode. We currently don't know whether Rust has different effective optimizations enabled in LLVM for fast build and debug modes, which would explain the huge performance difference. And the last learning, which was also not shown here for lack of time, is that the overhead of unwrapping options and results eventually adds up. The same is true for checked casts. The way we realized this was that the code used to have unnecessary unwraps that, once removed, improved the Rust code performance, bringing it to parity with C++. It then created a commit for investigation purposes where it replaced all checked casts by blind casts, and this also caused some performance improvement. Let's talk about productivity and code quality in Rust. First of all, I do feel more productive in Rust than in C++. This feeling started after I understood more about ref cells and lifetimes, which happened after I struggled with them. Also, Rust has features that don't have equivalent in other languages I know. For example, the borrow checker, ref cells, pin, or lifetimes. Learning to think about them took a bit of time, but once they clicked, I was able to use them productively. In terms of designing data structures, Rust forces you to reason about things that C++ does not, like object lifetimes and simultaneous mutable and immutable borrows. I do believe that thinking about these things helped to design data structures better and avoid surprising bugs. For example, whenever I thought the borrow checker, it was because the code was doing weird things or the data structure was connected in unexpected ways. For example, some of them were self-referential, and use the self-references for both writes and reads. When we talk about quality in terms of code readability and confidence that it does what you would expect, I believe the quality of the Rust port is very similar to the original C++ implementation. But still, Rust is slightly better because it is explicit about integer type coercions and wrapping arithmetic overflows. It has lifetimes, which document invariants and help reason about how the data structures are connected. The code passes the borrow checker, which guarantees that use after free or accessing uninitialized pointers did not happen outside of unsafe blocks. Rust code is less verbose when doing simple operations, like reading a file content into a buffer, reading from a buffer to an integer of a specific size, or dealing with endianness. Rust also hides architecture-dependent logic away from the programmer. For example, it didn't require the use of compiler butyns. And lastly, writing print statements is much simpler, since they don't change depending on the type being printed. Nonetheless, Rust was more verbose in a few places, especially when some domain type was wrapped in option, box, ref cell, pin, or RC. This means that not only the types are longer, but it also leads to verbosity in code that uses them, because we need to explicitly unwrap some of these types. We need to call borrow or borrow mute to get the value contained in a ref cell. You also need to call unwrap to access the value inside an option that you know must be present. And C++ does not require any of this because it trusts the programmer blindly, avoiding these runtime checks. Finally, let's talk about the main learnings of this project. First learning was that doing the migration in two steps was a good strategy in general, but it would avoid any non-trivial changes in the first pass, like converting pointer and length pairs into slices. Even if Rust code does not look very idiomatic, or it needs more unsafe blocks than would be ideal. The second learning is that improving test coverage and refactoring code, for example using std span instead of pointer and length pairs, before migrating to Rust is very helpful. Improving the API can also be useful if possible. This decreases the number of bugs while porting and increases the migration speed. The third learning is that when using unsafe, one should justify why use after free does not happen and why the exclusivity rule is not broken. And reviewers should push back if it's not 100% clear why that is true. Also, having access to a group of Rust experts can help come up with alternative solutions. The fourth learning is that there is a non-trivial risk of human error, even when doing a simple mechanical translation from C++ to Rust. Another learning is that there is no statistically significant performance difference between the C++ and Rust implementations of WOFF2 and Opt mode, both in terms of memory usage and execution speed. And the last big learning, which I did not show in this presentation, is that Clippy was extremely helpful in improving code quality. So that's all I had for you today. Thank you for listening, and I hope you found this interesting.